and welcome to Match Day Live. As City continue their quest for three trophies, we are away to Crystal Palace in the Premier League. And you can see there's Pep Guardiola arriving and his team are arriving at Selhurst Park as well. And after Wednesday's fantastic 4-1 victory over Aston Villa, Pep's team will be looking to continue the momentum ahead of just that little trip to Madrid next week. Now, this is the first place, as always, to get your team news, and I'm going to be giving you that team news in about 90 seconds. But do you know what? I'm going to let you know right now, because I can't wait to tell you. Kevin De Bruyne and Erling Haaland both start today. So the team is arriving. And of course, City have a great record at Selhurst Park, unbeaten in the last 8 Premier League away games there. It's a 2-1 loss back in April 2015. We've kept clean sheets, 6 of them in a row since then at Selhurst Park, conceding just 2 goals in that run. And there is Erling Haaland, and he starts today. Let's do it. Here's your team news for today. Here is the City team. So in goal, it is still Stefan Ortega. And then it is a back four: Lewis, Stones, Diaz and Gvardiol. Rodri, captain Kevin De Bruyne is back in the starting 11. And then you have a start today for Oscar Bob. It's Alvarez, Grealish, and he's back. It's Erling Haaland. So that's the starting 11 for today. The subs bench: Ederson back on the bench. And then it's Kovacic, Doku, Bernardo, Gomez, Akanji, Nunes, Foden and Sissoko. So gutted if you've got Foden in your fantasy team, just like I have. Right, let's have a look at the Palace team news now. So in goal for Palace, it's Henderson. And then it's Ward, Anderson, Lerma, Munoz, Wharton. Captain is Hughes, Mitchell, Eze, Mateta and Ayew. So that's Palace's team for today. So nice early team news. Welcome to Match Day Live. Thank you very much for joining us today as City take on Palace in the Premier League. And you know it's going to be an absolutely cracking show today. We are here bright and early for you, and we are joined by two very special guests in the studio. One of our absolute favourite regulars, Steve Howey, is back. Hi, Steve.
Good morning.
Good morning. Lovely to see you. And then we're very, very excited. He's back on Match Day Live by popular demand. Please welcome back Ian Holloway. Hey, Ian.
Hi, Ian. How are you?
I'm wonderful. I'm very excited to have you, because I didn't... Last time you were on Matchday Live, it wasn't me that was with you, so this is our first one.
Yeah, but you're so well-coordinated with that sofa, I just can't get over it. You have gone... Not even handbags anymore, Steve. Look, you look wonderful.
Am I blending into the sofa?
No, you've matched your gear with it. It's unbelievable.
Was there even the grey puma?
Even the grey puma stripe. Unbelievable.
It's not an accident, Ian. Nothing here is an accident ever. And I'm very much enjoying your flat cap
Thank
as well.
It's
lovely to see you both. So instant sort of reaction to the team news there, Steve. Kevin De Bruyne and Erling Haaland back in the starting 11. Were you expecting that?
Yeah, but then again, I mean, sometimes when we've done this for a lot of time, a lot of times you don't know what Pep's going to do. You look at in midweek and obviously both were out. Phil Foden's not included today again, which is a shock because the lad's absolutely flying. But it's still a very, very strong team. Again, the Crystal Palace players will be looking at the team sheet and every name. They're like, wow, brilliant player, brilliant player. So it's going to be a tough ask for them, but absolutely delighted those two are back.
It's lovely to see Oscar Bob in the starting 11, Ian. Pep just likes to keep us on his toes, doesn't he? Like, you never really know what's going to happen.
The beautiful thing about it, he sees them all every day and he has to plan, not just for one trophy, to try and win 3 again at least, because that'll be failure to him. But it's wonderful to see how he believes in everybody. And if he's done this decision, if he's made this decision to put Oscar in, particularly how well he did, he come and got the winner when he came off the bench before, and you know, it's a joy. You'll get the right reaction. So it's a tough place to go. It really is, Palace. You know, if those fans turn up and you've got a great record there. But I have to say, and I know I'm on your telly, but your man is a genius. I have seen some wonderful managers. I've been up against an awful lot of them. For me, he's just another level in his thinking. I've seen it being taken around this wonderful bit, that the input he must have given to this club to build this place. I don't want to go home. It's that wonderful. No, if I was a kid...
You don't need to.
If I was a kid, no wonder you're proving to be the best of the best because of your surroundings. There is nothing to stop you. It's absolutely incredible. And that's down to that man's thinking. So just Hats off to him, honestly. I think he's an absolute genius.
What a way to start the show, Ian. You're very welcome. You're very welcome here. We like to have you here. Yes, thank you for joining us.
No, but most people would worry that Phil is in his form, but Pep doesn't do that. You sit there, because he'll be thinking two or three games ahead as well. Yeah. Let's get this one done. On my life, it's absolutely incredible. The amount of rest that you will need, mental rest, it's not physical rest, it's mental rest. To keep going all the time is really difficult with the same people. And if you have a dip in the wrong time, you won't get what you got last year, which was a treble. So your man is on it, he's at it, and he's probably the only one who doesn't get a rest. I feel for his wife and I feel for his family because I've been there. No wonder Jurgen wants a rest and he needs to pack in, because these men are absolutely outstanding individuals.
Yeah, because, of course, we played Wednesday, we play Real Madrid on Tuesday as well. This is a 12:30 kickoff today. It is that thick and fast time of the season that we love so much. If we're looking at that, the front setup in the team today, Steve, so obviously we know where Rodri will be, then De Bruyne, Bob, Alvarez, Grealish and Haaland. Give me a quick sort of tactical assessment of where you think they're going to be.
Well, again, I think, Jack normally is on the left. He's very, very good at that position and kind of sucking players in. We know Haaland's obviously he's going to be in the main up front. Alvarez, is he just going to be in that little hole? Will sometimes De Bruyne go ahead of even both of them at times? Regardless of where they are, they will start in a certain position, but they won't stay there. Mm-hmm. They'll move about. And I think that's the one for the opposition players, because they'll be thinking, right, well, I've had a couple of exchanges against Jack, I've done quite well, and now all of a sudden I'm against Alvarez. Now all of a sudden you've got Kevin De Bruyne popping up on the left or popping up on the right, and defenders are kind of thinking, I don't know where I am. That's one of the things that actually puzzles and kind of outdoes opposition teams, because of the movement. They're never static, they're always moving. So whilst they will be in their initial starting setup, they won't stay there.
I love that, Ian. I love that, because it's so true, isn't it? Like, you think you're getting, OK, I've worked out Grealish, and then all of a sudden there is someone else there, and then you look to the bench and you see that who's warming up. And we like to keep opposing teams on their toes, Ian.
What you do, you stretch their back line, however many they got in it. Most people will put five in there because you're so good. And you stretch them as wide as you possibly can. And I guarantee you, if you come in too early, Pep won't pick you. You've got to be out wide, and you've got to be out wide both sides. And that then leaves your two number 10s, because you have two, really. Alvarez can go anywhere he wants and he can go past. De Bruyne, with that wonderful delivery that he's got from either side. But he likes to just float in that little outside pocket just back from your right winger. And the brains that they've all got, it all works, you know? And the hardest thing for me is that Haaland is absolutely magnificent as a counter-attacking team. He's so quick. He's always hurting the back of the defence, which nobody likes today. You always see the play in front of you. So it's absolutely unbelievable to watch for me. And it must be horrendous to try and stop it as a manager. I've actually sat there and thought, what are you going to do? But they're getting better and better at it. And the patience, the build-up, and if they can't get in down that side, they'll come out and they'll go over the other, and they keep, and you feel pressured in. So it's incredible, the talent that he's got everywhere. But he'll do that for a weakness that he'll see in Palace. He can do the same thing, but he'll find a weakness in Palace, and he will pick those players deliberately to get that, knowing that the other ones are still fresh, ready to go if he needs. And he don't normally use them, does he, really? You know, and which is unusual. Normally we have to give him a rest, but it's wonderful the way. I'd love to be a fly on the wall here and see what he does just for once, because I've been here and I feel like I've never managed anybody after I've seen this place.
Well, do you know what, Ian? There's a documentary on Netflix called Together, the Treble Winners, and it gets you inside, you get to see inside.
No, that's wonderful. That's wonderful for you Man City people, but I would want to go further than that. I want to see when he's thinking on his own and he's not with anyone. They won't show that. What does he think? He's on another level.
I think the biggest compliment you can pay Pep and the team and the players that they've got. You look at last week against Arsenal, and Arsenal's supposed to be going for the title. Look what they did. They were obviously terrified of the movement of City, and so they just went, basically, everybody behind the ball. We'll try and maybe catch them on a counter-attack, but that's Arsenal, and they're supposed to be, you know, wanting to go for the titles themselves. So I think that's a huge compliment. Whilst the game itself wasn't what everybody wanted, it was frustrating for City, but that's a big compliment for me because obviously Arteta's looked at it and thought, we can't afford to play against these the way that I would normally play against them.
Yeah.
And that's why they do what they do.
Can I just say that? As a manager, I was trying to get towards that we do this 100% of the time. And then this is what we do, lads, and make them believe that they can do it. And then you go, maybe take 5, 15% off of that and talk about their set plays. They do this, they score from this, so let's stop that. But really, you're talking about us growing and building. I think Man City are one of the only teams who can actually do that nearly 99% of the time and say, we'll beat them. Right down to what your manager does. And their understanding of when to go back out and go is, it's not easy to get, you know, but they're forcing it all the time. And it, honestly, it's changing the game because everybody's trying to do it and they can't do it like he can. And for me, he could have taken the worst player in the world and he would make him an awful lot better. Oh. That is my honest appraisal of your manager. He gets the best of the best and he still changes them and makes them better. You know, and he makes them better people first. He makes them care more. And that's what I love about him.
Mm. Oh, I love that, Ian. I love that. I'm hoping today's one of the 99% days, obviously, as well. Thank you. Thank you to both of you. So we've sent FG down to Selhurst Park. He's joined by Kit Symons. And FG, Ian Holloway's come looking very dapper. He's in his flat cap because all the cool kids are wearing flat caps these days. So, FG, got a flat cap?
Yes, thank you very much, Nat. Welcome to Selhurst Park. Of course, we didn't get the memo from the cool kids, the flat cap. I am joined by Kit Symons. First things first, let's address the elephant in the room. What was the inspiration behind the flat cap?
Well, me and Ollie got together. We decided it was a great idea. Back to South East London, get your flat cap on, you know.
South East London indeed, get your flat back on. Hopefully, me and Nat will get one for the next Matchday Live. Let's talk about the Manchester City team news. We've seen the team, and it's an interesting team. Some starts for Oscar Bob, who we're super excited to see. But let's start with Josko Vardiol, shall we? A player who, in my opinion, has gone under the radar ever so slightly. He spoke to Manchester City's media this week about how he wants to play in a bit more of Pep wants him to play in a bit more of an attacking role. What do you make about his role in this team?
Well, he's a fantastic player, first and foremost. Obviously made his name really predominantly as a centre-back. So he's been asked to do something very different for him this year. Not only play left-back, but play left-back in a Pep Guardiola Man City team, which is a different thing altogether. But he's certainly coming to grips with it. He's getting forward more and more. And he's been really positive, I think, this season.
It makes a huge difference, especially in games when it's very, very difficult to break the side down. We saw against Arsenal, actually. Arsenal sort of left him out wide and defended the middle of the pitch and stopped everything through the middle. So in terms of him from an attacking point of view, you imagine in this team, Pep's wanted him to offer a lot more in an attacking sense.
Well, so at times, the fullbacks in a City side end up being the highest players in the team, you know, due to the rotation and the movement and stuff. So it's important that he can pose a threat, and I think that's starting to come. You know, it's an unusual and alien role for him, and he's developing the role, and he's getting better and better at it all the time.
Now, of course, we have to focus on John Stones being back as well. We think is going to partner Ruben Dias at centre-half. Now, I'm sure the City fans watching Matchday Live will remember the lockdown times where it was Ruben Dias and John Stones at centre-half together. They have such a great understanding of each other, and they are two top centre-halves, aren't they?
Well, that's right. We are quite lucky in that centre-back department with the options that we've got. But certainly those two playing together. And it's important, I feel, to get that relationship and understanding as a defensive partnership, as a centre-backs, as a pairing.
Now, Kevin De Bruyne back in the starting lineup with Erling Haaland. Kevin wearing the armband this afternoon. The importance of Kevin De Bruyne is so is clear for everyone to see. But is it so important that Erling Haaland's sake that Kevin's behind him?
Well, certainly. I mean, he finds him all the time, and he's looking there on the same wavelength, clearly. And you know, the assists he can give, and the balls he plays. He plays balls that aren't really on for anyone else to play. You know, no one else would see it, but Haaland will make the movement and make the run, and De Bruyne has already played the ball. You know, it's incredible, like the telepathy that the two of them have together. So he's. I mean, for a centre-forward like Erling Haaland, having Kevin De Bruyne playing must be a dream.
from one Norwegian to another, a start for Oscar Bob. Really nice to see. He's impressed every time he's played in a City shirt. What do you like so much about his game?
It's just he plays with like no fear at all. He looks like he's absolutely just really enjoying his football, playing football. He's still got that young kid element about him where he just loves kicking about sort of thing almost. And he plays with freedom. But also saying that, he's, you know, in the Guardiola side, you can't just do what you want. You've got to fit into the team structure, which is obviously football intelligent enough to do that quite comfortably. And I mean, for club and country this season, he's been excellent. And again, he's one who'll just keep getting better and better.
Well, we hope so. And one man who's kept getting better and better every season is actually on the bench this afternoon. It's Phil Foden. Do you think this is because what we touched on in the last game when we were on Matchday Live, just managing minutes? He played a couple of games for England as well, whereas Kevin and Erling had their rest.
I can't believe he's been dropped, really. It's incredible, yeah. But no, he's resting up, and it's going to be a squad game between now and the end of the season. Everyone's going to get utilised.
And, of course, on to Palace, the home team today. An interesting start for Dean Henderson. So he's a number two as well, a very high-quality number two, just like Stefan Ortega is as well. As a former manager, how do you deal with the personalities in between the sticks, the goalkeepers? Because only one of them can play, and normally it's your number one and your number one only, apart from cup competitions.
I mean, they're special goalkeepers, and you want them to have... And the goalkeeping coach develops that great relationship within their little goalkeeping group. So generally, if it's two sort of number ones vying, they're really pleased for each other when they get their opportunities. But it's quite a topical thing now. It used to be like a definite number one and a number two, but a lot of the big clubs now have two number ones vying for that position.
And quickly as well, before we head back, Eze, a man who can grab the game by the scruff of the neck. He's done so many times at Selhurst Park. He's vital for Palace today as an outlet, isn't he?
Very, very important. If Palace are going to create something like some sexy football at all, some good opportunities and chances, it's going to come from him.
Well, OK, absolutely brilliant. That was our reaction to both team news. Let's head back to the studio from one flat cap to another.
Thank you to FG and to Kit Symons. I didn't get the memo, Steve, did you, about the flat caps?
I didn't, but I don't think he's got a heat of Gili, though, has he?
Oh, and we do. And we do, although it's April, so I guess he's hoping he doesn't need it anymore.
Well, I wouldn't have thought the flat cap either, especially inside as well.
It's fashion, isn't it, Ian?
That's just to save on the powder on the top of my head, mate.
So that was the thoughts of FG and of Kit Symons. Kit mentioning Phil Foden there. I just want to quickly pick up on that before we talk about the Crystal Palace team, because I would imagine it is a tactical choice. It is a resting of Phil Foden. It's certainly not a dropping.
Yeah, Ollie mentioned it before. I think it's just a case of just giving him a rest. I mean, he is in unbelievable form. You're just seeing more and more of what I'm classing as the Foden turn. Now, you know, it's one of them ones where he has that quick little look over his shoulder, and he does initially go to the ball kind of front on. But then as the ball comes, he does the turn, whether it's left or whether it's right, and he opens play up. You've seen it time and time again where it opens, does the defender, and he's actually through, or he's got that turn and he's sliding somebody else in. I mean, that turn is absolutely quality, and he's got that off to the team. Defenders can't do anything about it. But, yeah, disappointed that he's not playing. But again, the manager, you know, you cannot go against the manager, because time and time again, you look at certain things and you just think, well, why is this and why is that? But it's always worked out. Now, as I said, he's flying, he'd be disappointed, but at the same time, it just gives him that rest. But we know the run-in's absolutely, you know, it's just so busy, and the Champions League as well. So the manager's obviously got his eye on the fixtures coming up just as much as what he has today.
Yeah, Pep has said in his pre-match interview that it is just tactical, it is just arresting. So, you know, given we've got Real Madrid on Tuesday night as well, and as Steve says, game after game now as well, it's wonderful, I think, that we've got someone like Oscar Bob that can come in with the fresh legs. So, we've got Ian Holloway here today, so we have to have a good old chat about Crystal Palace now. First of all, Ian, give me your general reaction to the Palace situation. Obviously, the situation with Roy and the new manager. How have you gauged Palace's season?
Personally, I'm disappointed. I thought Roy did. He came in last year after Patrick Vieira, and everybody was moaning, what are they doing? And he just settled the ship. He got more out of Eze. Eze Abire, who's such a wonderfully talented boy. Absolutely, I had the joy of giving him his debut. But as partly a Palace fan as well, I was disappointed. I thought, you know, they must be lacking somewhere in that team on a regular basis in this level. They've done ever so well to stay there. They've had different managers doing it. And then, you know, I would have loved Roy to have stayed, kept him up this season, and then give it to a new one. It's very hard for Oliver Glasner to take over at that period. And if you look at his results, he's had one win, which was against Burnley with 10 men, and then two defeats and two draws. So it's very, very tough. But it's a club I know well. They've got unbelievably talented players, but it's about the balance of learning how to win. And there's something not quite right for that squad at the moment. Do you get what I mean? And I don't think it was Roy. I think Roy's done a brilliant job. Mm. And along with Ray Lewington. You know, they knew what they were doing. And that's very tough sometimes. If you're not quite good enough to open teams up, you know, you might have to be a little bit more solid, which Roy made us, a little bit more solid. And then counter-attacking and breaking with the talent that we've got and try and get that right. But they didn't score enough goals. They let too many in. And it's... I could understand it, but it did upset me.
Eze is a phenomenal player. So you gave him his debut. When was that? Tell us about that.
At QPR. Yeah. He was doing so well in the youth team that brought him up to train with the first team. And it wasn't a problem. Physically, it might have been. He wasn't as fit as he could have been. I had a little bit of puppy fat on him and we used to tease him. But then I loaned him out to Wickham. And he was doing so well under Gareth. Gareth was really clever, Gareth Ainsworth. He let him drop back in and just chase their deepest line midfielder. Because without the ball, he didn't quite get it. But talent-wise, it was a joy. I've never seen anyone move like him. He's very different. He's not got electric pace, but he just floats and drifts past you. And how he does it, I don't know, with both feet. So I've really enjoyed the fact he's got in the Palace team. He went for a lot of money and he's just such a wonderful kid. And they don't tick unless he is. Do you get what I mean?
He very much.
Elise is very good as well, but he has got some that X factor.
Yeah, he's always in transfer windows, Steve. He's always linked to other big clubs as well, obviously pushing England as well. He's a phenomenal player. Is the key for City today to keep him quiet?
Yeah, but I think City's plan is what can we do?
Yeah.
I think Ollie again had mentioned it. It is a case of, I think Palace will be looking at that and they'll be looking at X, Y and Z players for Manchester City. Of course, they'll want to try and counter that by putting City under pressure. But at the same time, I think he might be thinking, I'm not going to get the ball this much this afternoon. He might have to track back and do the stuff that he doesn't really want to do. But when he gets the ball, he's going to have options as well. And if he doesn't get options, you can understand why some players will get frustrated. And I think that's what the City players want. They want players like him to get frustrated and downhearted. Because obviously, if his confidence is up and he's getting the ball, then yeah, it can cause you problems. But if he's playing in a game, and hopefully today is one of them games where he's not really getting a sniff and he's not getting the ball, and when he does get the ball, he's getting shut down or there's not options for him, I think it'll be one of them games where he's just thinking, let's just try and get out of this game. Let's, you know, get this game done and let's move on to another one. But he's certainly, as Ollie said, he's a fantastic talent.
You mentioned Elise a minute ago. He's been out, I think it's 7 games, but he's back on the bench today. So even though it's the bench, for them to have him back in the squad, that's going to be a boost for Palace.
It's absolutely vital for Palace. And you know, as I say, one or two players give them the qualities that you've got everywhere, if I can put it that way. Do you know what I mean? You don't, being lower down in this level, you don't really get the beautiful skills that these lads have got. And he's definitely got that. And I was at this game at home and they come out of nowhere. Yeah. You know what I mean? Didn't they? And it's down to that little bit of extra talent. They've always had it with Wilfred Zaha. I've always loved Wilfred. The minute I managed him, I thought this kid is so, so special.
Yeah, and Mateta scored in this game as well, didn't he? Is he going to be a threat today, do you think, Ian?
He can be. He's a big, strong, sort of old-fashioned number 9-ish, but he's also got an awful lot to him, and it's going to be the counter-attacking. Can Palace tie up Man City? Can they? Can they do it with that flair still in the team, and the flair doesn't normally... There you go, it's a great ball.
This is Mateta's goal in that game.
Yeah, he does ever so well to get on. It's a great cross, but that ball should have been stopped at source. Right, and the two centre-halves should have never let that go like that.
There's not many people that get the better of Ruben Diaz, by the way.
No. No, but it was sloppy there. That was sloppy. The only bit of sloppy defending. Steve, you know that. A ball over the top like that, you've got to be there first, haven't you?
Yeah, you're getting criticised for that because it's a simple straight ball, really. It should be, you know, food and drink, really, to the centre-half, especially the quality of City. And even the ball that gets across, can the goalkeeper do a little bit better on that one? But I was at the game as well, and it was one of them ones where, as you said, it had just come from absolutely nothing. It was more than comfortable, and then all of a sudden they get two goals like they did. I mean, obviously the penalty is a definite penalty, but that goal, it's something that the manager would have been and the players would have been disappointed with.
Yeah, absolutely, because there really is not many people out there that get the better of Ruben Diaz and then Nathan Ake as well. So, yes, let's hope that that is cut out today. Thank you very much. So, we're keeping FG busy down at Selhurst Park today. And he's found, randomly, Joe Cole. So, here is FG speaking a little bit earlier to Joe Cole.
Yes, thank you very much. As you can see, I am joined here at Selhurst Park, outside Selhurst Park at the Fan Zone, by Joe Cole. Joe, first things first, thoughts on the game today?
Oh, you can't see anything other than a Manchester City win up. Palace, there's been an improvement under Glasner, but Manchester City is just a joy to watch, you know. You boys are having it off up there, aren't you? Let's be honest. Fantastic. I love watching, you know, Foden, De Bruyne, Grealish, Haaland. It's like, yeah, it's just... If Man City's on the box, you're watching. So I can only see Man City winning. Although I think Palace will keep them honest for the first half an hour.
Well, there's something about early kickoffs. There's a lot of people who seem to speak about early kickoffs being a little bit different and stuff.
Yeah.
As a former player, what can you remember from playing in the early game?
Yeah, I mean, it was, you had to adjust whatever routine you had. Eating at that time of the morning is not a pre-match meal isn't great because you have a routine, don't you? So, I know it sounds silly for some people, but some people might want a pasta and chicken as a pre-match and they want to keep that going. So eating pasta and chicken at 9 in the morning, no matter how much you love food like me, wasn't great. But and there's just the atmosphere is different. Sometimes you have to drive the atmosphere, you know, because people haven't had all day to look forward to it, had a few drinks at the pub, and the crowd are up for it. It's a different type of atmosphere. So but the good thing is, the positive thing is, if you get a win, you've got all of Saturday to enjoy, and then you sit back and watch the other teams hopefully trip up.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. It could put you in a good position today. Let's talk about Phil Foden then. Manchester City player who's been absolutely incredible. Of course, a hat-trick midweek. What do you make of his performances and his level? Because he seems like he's still got so much more to offer.
Oh, mate, he's incredible. What a footballer. You know, I think he's going to go on. His name will be down with the greats when his career finishes. I've no doubt about that. Just a great player. Lucky enough to interview him. You know, I love the way he plays, but his head's screwed on. He's in the perfect place. His own club got arguably the best manager in the world, the best style of play, perfect for him. He never has to leave. Right? He's just having it off. Absolutely love watching him play.
Going back to your days of playing, if you had to put Phil Foden in the same bracket of a player that you played with at that time, who would you compare him towards?
Played with or played...
I mean, either, just in your area, I mean...
I think he's I think he's a bit like Iniesta. Yeah, I didn't play with Iniesta, but, like, listen, he can surpass him. I really believe that. You know, he's... Him and Jude, I think, are arguably the two best number 10s, young number 10s, in world football. There'll be a few others like you. Yeah, your Gavis and Pedris in midfield. Camavinga's a bit different, but them two together, like, outstanding footballers.
That is absolutely incredible praise from yourself. Now, from one Man City Academy graduate to another, and one who playing for your former club at the minute, Cole Palmer, on absolute fire, and a hat-trick, of course, as well, midweek. What do you make of Cole, and a similar sort of question to Phil, because it feels like him being the main man has made a massive difference in Chelsea, hasn't it?
Yeah, and he is the main man. Like, I don't know what you're feeding him up there in that academy, but you're doing a great job. Keep sending him south. Love Cole. He's been Chelsea's best player this year, and again, sky's the limit for him. He can achieve whatever he wants in the game. Top draw.
And quickly before we head back, FA Cup semi-final coming up. City yet to beat Chelsea this season.
Yeah.
How do you see that game going?
Well, my heart will tell me Chelsea, but it's trying to work out how to beat your Man City team is a very tough ask. But the positive signs at Chelsea now, if they can give the energy that they did against Manchester United the other day, we'll have a chance.
I think we can all agree we enjoyed the game against Manchester United the other day. We've enjoyed having you here on MatchDay Live as well. So thank you so much, Joe
Cole.
My
pleasure.
Let's head back to the studio.
Love that. Thank you so much, Joe Cole, bringing the proper Cockney to MatchDay Live today as well. And comparing our Phil Foden to Iniesta. And last week, I think it was Emmanuel Petit compared him to Thierry Henry as well. So, go on, Phil. That's some pretty decent comparisons there. So, thank you to FG and to Joe Cole. Now, we have a very special surprise for you all on MatchDay Live today, because we're going to be revealing the Etihad Player of the Month winner for March. Are you ready, gents? Are you ready to find out who it was? A big congratulations to, of course, the one and only Rodri. So Rodri is our player of the month for March. So March's games were Arsenal, United, Copenhagen, Liverpool, Newcastle, and Arsenal, 3 wins and 2 draws, and another great month for Rodri. Now, I've got a quick question for both of you. You may confer if you want. How many games has Rodri played for City since he last lost a game?
I think it's not in the 50s.
I'd take a guess if you want. Confer with Ian if you want.
I know it's a stupid amount of games.
It's a silly amount of games. How vital is he?
I did hear the stat last week, but maybe normal. I forgot it.
OK. What are you guessing?
Is it 50-ish then, 60?
Give me a guess.
Go, mate.
I thought it'd be even more than that. I'll say 100.
I wish it was.
58-ish.
63 games since Rodri last was
63,
beaten.
That's scary.
Well, I have predicted that you're not going to lose.
Yeah, he's got a head.
We'll look at this again. So you've got to go back to the 5th of February 2023. It was a 1-0 league defeat away to Spurs. That was the last time that Rodri was beaten. I mean, he is just... Ian, how highly do you rate our Rodri?
Rodri is the perfect player for what Pep wants to do. And the whole thing is, it's all smoke and mirrors. And I remember when he was at Barcelona and he said, we've just beaten Arsenal at Arsenal. They won 2-1. And they couldn't keep the ball for more than 4 seconds against my team. And you all talk, and he was laughing, talking about tippy-tappy. It's not about, he don't care about that. It's what you do when you haven't got a ball. And Rodri is the perfect scenario. He breaks up the counter-attack against you, or he breaks up their attack, full stop. And then when you get the ball, everything else is, we've practiced this, come on. It's so vital to what you do. But he sets the tone of what you do when you haven't got the ball. And for me, Phil Foden, fantastic. He's all of those, he could be all of those. But when he hasn't got the ball, he will sprint twice as fast back to get it than he does going forward. And that's what your manager has bred in all of them. So Rodri is his main star. I bet he's first on the team sheet over and over again, because he's totally unique to what you do.
For me, he's the best player in the world in his position.
Absolutely.
By far. Not close, by far. But again, as Ollie said, you look at the work rate of Man City, and you look at any of the Pep teams, but just recently Man City when played Aston Villa, just recently, they're winning the game comfortably. In the last few minutes, one of Aston Villa players has got the ball. You can see 3 City players running so quick, so hard to get back to try and get the ball off him. And the game's done. And it just goes to show the kind of the mentality that these players have.
I can liken him to somebody, right?
Oh, please.
And you've got to be my sort of age to remember, but Franz Beckenbauer, right? For me, Rodri is even better than he was.
Wow. So you've got Beckenbauer, Iniesta and Henry.
How many bigger names could we drop into the show today?
But they're all going to be stars in their own right. People will be talking
absolutely
them for years. Phil Foden is a unique Phil Foden.
Yeah.
Rodri's also having a great season, a goal-scoring season as well. So he's on 8 goals and 12 assists this season, which is... he's a holding midfielder. It's ridiculous, Steve. Those numbers by themselves are ridiculous.
Well, again, it just goes back to my point where, yes, his position is possibly just in front of the back four and he breaks everything up. But it just brings me back to the point that I made before. They'll start in these positions, but they move around. So he does find himself up in that final third quite a lot. I mean, obviously, he's very good from set plays as well, because he's, you know, big, tall lad. But we've seen him, the goals that he scored and the important goals that he scored as well, the Champions League last year. I mean, the Champions League final. I mean, there's one, but obviously leading up to it as well, the goals that he scored. But it doesn't surprise me because he's got the quality. I mean, some people might just think, oh, he's a destroyer. But he's not. He does that brilliantly. But he's all-around player, he's passing and everything, reading of the game, is just quality.
And as a human being as well, I mean, I love the fact that he's just not on social media. I just love that. And I like that he tucks his shirt in, Ian. I imagine you're a fan of that.
I would have been killed if I didn't do that. My dad would have absolutely murdered me. And a fella called Gordon Bennett would have gone mad at me. He wouldn't let me play. You got a bit of discipline. Tuck your shirt in.
Apparently, there's a rumour going around that I've heard that he's had a bet with the players if he scores a certain amount of goals, they're all going to tuck the shirts in one day.
Oh, wow, that'd be good.
I hope it happens.
Yeah.
I'm desperate for it to happen. So he's won the March Player of the Month award. And, of course, we played Villa the other night in April and he was phenomenal in that game as well. So he's already setting himself up for an April nomination because he was just imperious in that game. Mm.
He's just a quality player. You just know what he's going to get. Again, agreeing with Ollie, the manager looks at his team and just goes, well, he's starting straight away. And as I said, he is the one. Yes, the manager might sort of let Kevin De Bruyne have a breather or Foden or Haaland or one or two other players. He is there week in, week out. I mean, that's a super finish. Gives the goalkeeper no chance. And look where he is. He's supposed to be the whole midfield player. And he's nearly in the six-yard box.
Well, that's the rotation that your manager practices. And they're used to it, but it's still what the manager wants, but with their expression. And he is so talented and so skillful. And look at John Stones playing centre half, and yet he's in midfield most of the time. He does those sort of things. So again, it's a unique way of playing that Pep is developing, and that's what I love about it. He's developing. He's having to develop his own thoughts on it because people will research it and look at it. And you do your stats on it, and the stats are unbelievable these days. And yet, Pep just tweaks it. What I loved the other day was he moved Phil Foden from one side over to the other. He came out and did it, and Phil scored. Mm. I mean, such a genius, because he knew, he could see. And whoever sits next to him, they're always talking. It's just wonderful. I don't know the fella's name. It's just wonderful. And Pep, and he goes on that, and then Pep's going like that, and he even bounced it off of him. I don't know. What's his name? Do you know his name?
No.
The little fella. He's a member of staff with grey hair. Unbelievable. Okay. Unbelievable.
Juan Malilo.
Yeah, Juan Malilo. You're a genius as well, because what you want to do is bounce it off of someone when it's happening. You can see it, you can feel it, and he might just know him so well, oh, there's a bit of a weakness there. Yeah. So he just moved them over. That is what wins you things.
You've got to watch the documentary by the way, Ian, because you would love it. You do see some of the team talks, and he's got his whiteboard out and he's moving and he's talking to his coaches. You'd love it.
No, I do love that, but there's other things that we'll never see because they should be private.
Behind the scenes.
Yeah, behind the scenes should be private, and that's the real Pep.
There we go.
So it's great to have a little look, but I know there's something else that you'll never show anyone.
Mm.
Well, congratulations to our Rodri. We love him so much. And he has won the March Etihad Player of the Month award. So we're going to head back over to Selhurst Park now to get FG and Kit Symons' reaction to the Player of the Month. And do you know what? FG's been playing a lot of football lately, gents. He's been putting up a lot of pictures on his social media. I've seen it. I'm wondering if FG's going for the Rodri style, and I'm wondering if he's going to start tucking his shirt in. Are you, FG?
Yes, as you can see, I'm actually trying to be like Rodri with everything tucked in. Our Player of the Month, Kit's not impressed at all, is he? Not the time?
I'm not sure you're quite pulling that one off somehow.
Well, there you go, we'll go back to normal then and keep it professional. Rodri, our Player of the Month. Manchester City fans absolutely adore this man, but I feel like the world of football is now starting to give Rodri the credit he deserves. He's so much more than just a defensive midfielder, isn't he?
Well, he is. He's taking it to another level now. I mean, his goals and his assists, and it's just his all-round running of the game. I mean, Foden's been so good, so for Rodri to win it shows how important he is to this team and how good he's been.
Yeah, there was, of course, a nomination for Phil Foden, not a surprise, and also Manuel Akanji, so a massive shout-out to them. We'll start with them, actually. Phil, of course, we've seen the goals, the assists, and we see, like, how he's really becoming a main asset in this squad.
Well, he's another one who's just loving his football, you can see, especially getting that more central role. He's absolutely thriving on it, and he's taking his game to another level again this season. This is It's his best season so far for City, and he's not done bad previously.
And Manuel Akanji as well has been absolutely brilliant, and he's really, really helped us at a time where we've needed someone there because we're a little bit short of the back. But it seems like Manu never really lets us down in a City shirt. He's a fantastic acquisition. Shout out to Cheeky and everyone for doing the incredible work. But a word on Manuel as well.
Yeah, he's a Rolls Royce. He just like strolls through games and looks so comfortable. Very good on the ball, stepping out now, obviously, which he needs to be able to do in this City team. And yeah, he's another one who's done fantastically well for us.
Now, Rodri as well, we spoke about him, of course, just coming into the segment. He's added so much more to his game in an attacking sense as well. Is there anything this man can't do?
No, doesn't seem to be at the moment, certainly. And he's, you know, just his record when he plays in a City shirt is how important he is to the team. But he controls the game as well. He sprays balls left and right, but the defensive side, we look so much more solid when he's in his position and there in front of the back four. But then he's, like I say, scoring goals and loads of assists this year as well. He's fantastic.
It is fantastic to see, indeed. And I tell you what, I mean, I think it's only right we take a trip down memory lane and discuss everything that you've done at this amazing stadium. Let's start with the beginning then, player first. How was that signing here from Fulham?
Yeah, it was good. I was Trevor France's first signing. Actually, my debut here was against Palace in a 1-1 draw. I remember nodding down for Dougie Freeman to get the Palace goal that day. But I had great times as a player. Unfortunately, I picked up an injury quite early on, which hampered me, and it's a bit disappointing that the Palace fans never really saw the best of me as a player. So that was a little bit disappointing. But then I had a little spell as player, caretaker, manager, which I absolutely loved as well.
Let's have a chat about that, because I did say, were you a caretaker, manager, Kit, at one point? And he said, no, I was a player, caretaker, manager. That is interesting, but the question for me is, as the amazing tactician you are, how many minutes did you get?
Well, what I used to do is I'd normally put myself sub, but if we were winning 1-0, which a couple of times here, I'd throw myself on for the last 5 minutes and see out the win. I remember one game, I think it was Coventry. We're 1-0 up and I didn't put myself on, and then they equalised the last couple of minutes, so I was kicking myself. So I could have got another 2 points to my tally, but never mind.
Being a part of the dressing room as a player, but then also doing the manager side of things, how easy was it for you to find that level of sort of, because you've got to have the manager side to you, but you've also got the player side as well. Were you still getting involved in the banter with the lads in the locker room, or was it just serious as you were manager?
It was quite difficult, to be honest, initially, because I sort of, at the back of my mind, I was always thinking I'd just go back to just being a player once it's happened. I mean, as it happened, I ended up becoming a player assistant then when Ian Dowie came in. But no, I was sort of club captain as well, so I was organising the Christmas parties and things like that for the boys. But because I was manager, I couldn't go.
I don't know about people watching MatchDay Live, but I would absolutely love to be managed by you.
Oh, yeah.
You also had a spell with the under-21s after that as well, which was obviously seeing the development. Palace have been brilliant with bringing players through their academy. What was the setup like back then?
It was good back then as well, very, very good. It's a real, it's a fantastic catchment area, this part of London. And they've always had a really strong academy, very well run, and as you say, bring some excellent players through. And they're continuing to do that and growing the academy all the time.
Well, it's been an absolute pleasure taking a trip down memory lane with you. But that's not all. People are watching MatchDay Live. We're going to head to the studio and it's going to be another trip down memory lane for our guests.
Thanks, FG. And Kit Symons, I'd love to see Kit training FG, by the way. I think he'd work him hard and I think FG needs it. And yes, it was lovely to hear Kit talking about his time at Palace. And yes, we'll do memory lane with Ian now, because, of course, Ian, former Crystal Palace manager. Mm-hmm. You managed them in the season of the Championship where you got promoted. Mm-hmm. What's your kind of key memories from that season?
It's quite mixed, really. I took over a club where the previous manager decided to leave, and he took five members of staff with him, which left me with no chief scout, no assistant manager, and with a group of that I was told that I got to try and get to play a different way. Now, they never really took to me, the players, because I didn't get my transition right. I should have embraced what they wanted to do rather than try and change it immediately. We went backwards on the pitch, and then I had to go back and say, right, we're going to do what you were doing, because they didn't want the ball at the back and I wanted them to have the ball and play. So we had to counter-attack. We were brilliant at it, absolutely brilliant at it. So I used their analysis to talk to me about what they did, and we went back to it, and it was like straight back in a slipper. Beautiful. Worked a treat, and we managed to get up by beating their biggest enemies, which are Brighton. We drew at home, lost Glenn Murray, who scored 31 goals for us with injury, and we beat them 2-0 over there, and then we managed to beat Watford 1-0 in the final. So absolutely wonderful club, fantastic place, and only lasted 8 games the next season in the top flight after having no chief scout and trying to make sure I didn't get a bad group of players.
Do you wish you'd had longer?
I'd have loved to have had longer. I was absolutely worn out. Steve Parrish and I fell out a little bit, to be honest with you. And he said something that worried me, and like, it's my show, not your show. And it's true, really, it was true. But I just needed a little bit of help at that time, and he decided that it wasn't right. And I think he made the right decision, I have to be honest. Tony Pulis came in. I did say you should get Tony. Tony would be brilliant with these lads because the back block he used to do for all the teams he had was brilliant, and it really suited them. And they raced up the table. Absolutely, I think they finished, was it 10th or 11th or something like that? Anyway.
Well, you got them promoted, and since then they've stayed in the Premier League, so 11 straight.
Yeah, how many different managers have they had? And
I'll start it from you.
They've tried to try and play in a more controlled way with the ball, which is difficult, you know. And at the end of the day, they had a group of players that got them there through playing that other way. And that's the transition, you know. What you're lucky with, you don't ever have to change the way you play. People will be trying to stop you and find it very, very difficult. Whereas parking the bus was the sort of Palace way of doing it. And it's very, very tough when you try and create and flow on top of that against a slightly lesser group of players. So it was a wonderful club. I wish it lasted longer. Would I have kept them up? I honestly don't know, because I wouldn't have wanted to do it like that. I'm all about the way Pep plays, but I'm not a poor man's Pep at all. I understood that we had to try and dominate the ball in the way that I wanted to see my team. And and unfortunately, that group didn't want it, and I don't blame them, you know? So Dougie's back there now, who was the fellow who left, and he's overseeing the whole lot of the club, and he deserves to be, because he built that, you know? Mm-hmm. He built it, and it's still there today, so well done.
Well, I think you are extremely popular by all fans for your managerial career, and also
not sure
for
about
your
Oh yes,
Ian, because you are the king of the quotes. We love your quotes. We love your character. We need characters like you in football, and you are very well known for your quotes. So we've had a little look through some of the best ones, picked out the PG ones that we could.
I was going to say
that we could say.
Here's one which is my favourite, but I'm not too sure about.
Can you not
one.
Say that at 12:15 on a
Probably
Saturday morning,
not.
Steve?
We'll see what comes up. No.
So here's
if
some.
If the grandkids are awake, don't say it.
Here's some of our favourite Ian Holloway quotes. So, every dog has its day, and today is a woof day. Today, I just want to bark.
Yeah, that's true. That was after I won a playoff final. I'd lost two beforehand. And that felt right, you know, because I was always brought up to be, winners aren't born, they're made. Winners are losers who never give up and keep going. And for me, that was me. I was always the underdog, and I really did go away and howl and bark after that.
OK, we love that one. We love this one as well, Ian. When my wife first saw Mark for the first time, she said he was a fine specimen of a man. She says I have nothing to worry about, but I think she wants me to buy her a QPR shirt with his name on the back for Christmas.
Yeah, we had this wonderful... He was 6'5". Steve, he was ripped as well, but I couldn't get him fit. And I said about this, I bought this bloke and... What was his second name?
Nygaard?
Yeah, Mike Nygaard. He was an old-fashioned number 9. I couldn't get him fit. He was so fit that he would break down left, right and centre. But honestly, if I could have looked like that, I would have paid money to look like that. You could have struck a match on anywhere around his midriff. Do you know what I mean? You know, honestly, it's like, what a specimen. Any chance you play him, Mark? Mm. He broke the record on this run that I used to have, and I did with all my clubs. He smashed it by at least 4 seconds, which is quite unbelievable. And, oh, I'm injured.
Mm. He may or may not be currently Googling him, Ian.
Honestly, you have a look at him. What a specimen. He's a lovely fellow as well, but I don't have to worry with my gorgeous wife. I took her glasses away from her.
Okay, the last one that we've got to mention. I love this one. When you were asked whether QPR would be able to beat Manchester City, you said, "I'm a football manager. I can't see into the future. Last year, I thought I was going to Cornwall on my holidays, but I ended up in Lyme Regis."
Yeah, my van broke down. I had a VW, old VW. I had it all done up and something flew off the side on the way down. We couldn't get there, so we pulled over. You know, we'd already booked a campsite somewhere else, but we found, you know, you've got to adapt and overcome, haven't you? You know, the holiday was still great, but we didn't even end up where we were supposed to be going.
and QPR did not beat City.
They didn't, no. They haven't for years, have they?
I love that. Can you repeat your favourite one or no?
It was, this little bit was the nightclub one. Oh. At 2 o'clock in the morning.
Oh, yeah. I didn't go to nightclubs very often. I met my wife at school, but we had a four-year period where we split up and I tried to go along with some of my better-looking mates, Keith Curl and Phil Kite. And I used to end up standing by their drinks and they'd be off people asking them to dance. So by that time, if you stayed to the end, the lights would come on. So I would never get a chance to dance with anyone when they come on. They could see what I really look like, do you know what I mean?
Keith Gill's a regular on our show, Ian. We'll have to ask him about it.
Honestly, are you pretty boy, I used to call him, honestly.
We'll tell him next time he's on and we'll ask him if you were his drinks minder.
It's quite embarrassing how people used to come over and ask him to dance. I did ask, I think, two people, and they both told me to go and do one.
Yeah, to be fair, my two teammates, I had Les Ferdinand and David Ginola.
That's how Dust me.
So, yeah. You just keep up the way.
Yeah. I'll hold your drink.
Yeah. Thank you.
I'll be back in 10 minutes. Thank they never you. Were back.
Thank you very much for being a good sport with that, Ian. I love to hear your side
honestly,
of those stories
that is,
as well.
I'm coughing. Here because, wow,
I love it. I love
wasn't expecting
it.
That.
I love it. Now, something else I love as well, I don't know if you saw this week, but you're going to love it. I don't know if you saw it, Steve. A new image of Pep Guardiola was taken and released this week. Pep with the 5 trophies, of course, that we currently hold. I mean, it is just a beautiful, beautiful... Oh, Ian, look at that.
Man. Yeah, I've seen that. It was quality.
Oh, that, Lord.
That is the stuff of dreams. Right? Wow. But that won't be enough for that man. Mm-hmm. He won't be happy if he don't see that again and again and again. And I've never known anyone like it, honestly.
Yeah, he'll look at that and he'd be so proud, but he'd be like, right, that was last year.
Yeah.
Let's do the same again this year.
Oh, man. Wow. What an
quality picture, isn't it?
Congratulations to everybody involved in that picture. It's absolutely phenomenal. Right, we are about 10 minutes away from today's 12:30 kickoff against Palace. We're going to go back over to Selhurst Park now to get the final thoughts from FG and Kit Symons.
Yes, thank you very much. Welcome back to Selhurst Park. We are about 15 minutes away from kickoff here, and the atmosphere here is building. The players are behind us, warming up. We've seen the team news, a start for Oscar Bob, a start for Erling Haaland, Kevin De Bruyne. Erling looked very, very sharp in his shooting practice, didn't he, Kit?
Yeah, he did. He'll be desperate to score a goal today and sort of lead the line. And, he's rested midweek, so he'll be firing on all cylinders today, I'm sure.
You can see the players now going inside, ready. So what goes through a player's head when you're this close to kick-off, running in, you've done your pre-match warm-ups. Is there anything extra that you do in the dressing room?
No, I mean, everyone's different. I mean, most players at this stage, though, now will be, like, fully focused and just, like, all geared up for, like, desperate for that. We sort of start now, but really getting in the zone now.
Really getting in the zone indeed, and our away support as well. The away section is looking great. There's a couple of poles in the way, which adds to the Selhurst Park atmosphere, but they've been making loads of noise already, haven't they?
Yeah, they have. It's going to be a great atmosphere in here today. It's a proper old-fashioned stadium, very tight to the pitch. City will be very, very vociferous in the away section, and Palace will also make a good noise about themselves.
Now, we don't really give enough coverage to Scott Carson, but you just saw on your screen a minute ago the laugh he's having with Mateo Kovacic. He was doing the goalkeeping in the warm-ups, and I tell you what, Kit, he's still got it, hasn't he?
He can still ping a ball, like, yeah, his service is pretty good as well. He's No, he's a great character, great part of the squad, and a real personality for sure.
And of course, Phil Foden was also doing his pre-match routines, doing some skills that I've never seen before. Once again, what a special talent he is.
Yeah, no, he's incredible. We're certainly very lucky to have him at City, and he clearly loves being here as well, so it's a good match.
And we're certainly very lucky to be here, and I'm very lucky to be here with you. So I'll see you at full time. We'll head back to the studio. Come on, City.
If I had something like that, I would.
Thank you, FG. Thank you to Kit Symons. So we are about 8 minutes away from today's kickoff. City taking on Palace. You'll get your full match commentary, as you always do, on the Manchester City app with Alistair Mann. And he is joined by, of course, the legend Andy Morrison today. So, gents, just before kickoff now, I'd love to get your final thoughts. We often get to this part in the show, Steve, and my stomach starts to jump when I realise it's a football game about to kick off. So, what's your thinking? How's it going to go today?
I'm going to go for a City win. I think, obviously, the pressure's on the top teams to get results. As Ollie said, it's a difficult place to go. 100% it is. But I think City will have enough for them. Do you want me to score prediction?
Hold on, give me 1 second. Let's get Ian's and then we'll blast it with the score prediction. Ian, what are you thinking? How's the game going to go?
You've had one freak result against them already this year at your place, and I can't see anything other than a Man City win. Because when the going gets tough, they certainly get going, and they know they've done it before, so it's muscle memory, and their manager is at them, you know?
OK, score prediction.
3-0.
Oh! OK, Ian?
I think Palace will have a go, and they'll do what they can. I think it'll be 1-3 to Man City.
Why?
Palace 1,
yeah, I was thinking about 3. 3-1, but then I've said 3-0. I'm delighted you haven't got, like you normally do, to City, though. To City. That's what normally happens.
I have to check sometimes, Ian. You never know. Why are you so confident?
I just think they know when the tough gets going, they get going. When it's getting tough, they step up. They've been there, they've seen that, done it. Listen, don't get me wrong, will they take an ugly 1-0? 100%. But I just think they might make a statement today.
I really hope that you are right so that we close in that goal difference gap that we've got on Liverpool as well. Importance of a psychological win today as well, Ian, given that we're playing before Liverpool and Arsenal?
Absolutely, yeah. The pressure is on. You know, squeaky bum time, as Fergie used to say, but you've been through that. Last year was squeaky bum time. You broke all sorts of records. What that man's done there could have been his whole career, but he's got all those trophies around. That was in one season, so it's still, can we do it again? Can we do it again with different players? But, you know, this is everybody's learning. Oscar Bob was going to step up. Everybody's growing. It's all growing, and it's all driven by the one man. For me, Palace have got it tough. And they'll take a probably 1-0against them today without, you know, what they don't want is a hammering. Anybody playing your team at the minute could get a hammer in it. Villa have been sensational this season. But, you know, this is the time it matters. And I believe you'll... It won't be a free score because I think Liverpool will keep going. And I think Arsenal are better than they were last year. But you are who I'm expecting to be a juggernaut and flatten everything around you.
Oh, Ian, I hope so. I hope so. And I know that Pep would say he's only thinking about this game, but I've got an eye on Tuesday and I would like a comprehensive win today, Steve, a good performance, a good few goals, just for that extra added bit of confidence for Tuesday.
Yeah, and obviously at the end of it, as I said, the manager will take a 1-0 win, but more importantly, no injuries. You know, everybody gets through absolutely fine. You get on the bus or you fly home or get the bus back on the motorway, job done. Let's look forward to Real.
But bravery, he's leaving out his best player at the moment. And Phil's his best player at the moment. He's in probably, just behind Rodri, you know. But his goal-scoring form, fantastic. Must be delighted. And yet, sit there, son. Here we go, with Oscar Bob.
I brought him into my fantasy football team this week as well.
Did you?
Phil. Oh, yeah. Oh, no.
You didn't have time to change it.
No, I didn't.
Oh,
I didn't. I got, gutted. Oh,
surprising,
well.
Actually, because you're normally like.
I'm still second in the league. I'm still second in the league, and I've got a chance. I've got a chance to close the top down. And Jolyon Lescott's breathing down my neck in third as well. So, anyway, it's time for a Premier League, a real football game. Thank you so much for joining us on Match Day Live today, Ian. It's been an absolute pleasure
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Steve. Enjoy Thank you for being here, as
Pleasure.
Always. Thank you all for joining us on Matchday Live. Thank you to FG and to Kit Symons. We will be back at half-time talking about, of course, hopefully, some goals in the first half, and at full-time, hopefully, talking about a Manchester City win. So enjoy your full match commentary now with the wonderful Alistair Mann and Andy Morrison.
Thanks, Natalie. So in a three-way title race, it is City's turn to play first, knowing that a victory can ramp up the pressure on Arsenal and Liverpool, who face tricky away games at Brighton and Manchester United. The defending champions may start the weekend in third, but a win at Crystal Palace this afternoon, slip-ups for the other title contenders, and the Blues could end the weekend at the top of the table. With eight games to go, it's shaping up to be one of the most fascinating and perhaps unpredictable title chases of recent years. Well, Crystal Palace have their own priorities, sitting 8 points above the drop zone, and new manager Oliver Glasner has opted to name the same side which lost at Bournemouth. It means the industrious and talented Eze, Ayew and Mateta remain intact, offering a genuine threat if they can wrestle possession off the Blues.